Good morning. We're so glad that you've chosen to worship with us today. I invite you to take a moment to pause and center yourself as we prepare our liturgy. Alleluia. Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
Alleluia. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose Son Jesus is the good shepherd of your people, grant that when we hear his voice, we may know him who calls us each by name and follow where he leads, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns one God forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Those who had been baptized devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Awe came upon everyone, because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common, would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all, as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising the Lord and having goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. The word of God for the people of God. Let us pray Psalm 23 in unison. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters. He revives my soul and guides me along right pathways for his name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. You have anointed my head with oil. and my cup is running over. Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
A reading from 1 Peter. It is a credit to you if, being aware of God, you endure pain while suffering unjustly. If you endure when you are beaten for doing wrong, what credit is that? But if you endure when you do right and suffer for it, you have God's approval. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example, so that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When he was abused, he did not return abuse. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that free from sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. For you were going astray like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "Very truly I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way, is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him because they do not know the voice of strangers." Jesus used this figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So again, Jesus said to them, "Very truly, I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved, and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord God.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you, O God. Well, thank you for being here this morning. So, last weekend, I broke the bonds of Corona house arrest and escaped to South Texas to the farm. On this farm lived two donkeys, Rosie and Susie. Rosie and Susie's job is to help take care of the baby calves by protecting them from coyotes and snakes and other kinds of things that want to kill baby calves. Now, if you've ever spent much time around domesticated farm animals, you know that they have, just like humans, distinct personalities. Rosie and Susie are no different. Rosie is gregarious. She'll let you stroke her muzzle and loves a good scratch behind the ears, and she'll put her face right up next to your chest and snuggle. Susie, on the other hand, well, you know that joke about mean old Mr. Crabapple? Hey, you kids, get off my lawn! That's Susie Donkey. She loves nothing better than to sneak up behind you and give you a little nip. Not enough to draw blood, but just enough to let you know that she does not want you in her personal space. So here's the deal. Rosie and Susie, well, they look remarkably alike to me. They're both donkeys. They're both whitish gray. They both stand about 5 feet tall. They're donkeys. And even though I've known Rosie and Susie for, gosh, well over a decade now, I still can't tell the difference when I drive up between lovable Rosie and curmudgeonly Susie. Mary, who owns the farm, however, Mary can tell the difference. She knows them, just like she knows the names and personalities of all the cattle. And they know her. They know her because, for example, like on Christmas Day when the newborn calf Max was abandoned by its mother, Mary brought him up to the barn and kept him warm and bottle fed him for weeks until he was able to be on his own. They know her because when Puddin' the horse had to have a tracheotomy, Mary was out there in the dark of the night cleaning the wound, helping Puddin' to breathe. Believe me, cleaning a tracheotomy wound on a 2,000-pound skittish animal requires a high level of knowing for both parties. They know her because even when they are not watching for her, she is watching for them. And when she calls the names of the now three little abandoned calves, come here, Max, and come here, Rojo, and come here, Sonia. Max and Rojo and Sonia, well, they come running. Now, mostly probably just to eat, but isn't eating together part of knowing each other? Rosie and Susie, Puddin', Max, Rojo, Sonia, they all experience life and living through Mary, who knows them, even when they're not looking. Which brings us to today's gospel story, the one about a shepherd named Jesus, who also happens to be the Christ. First, let me give you a little context, because John's timeline is different than the other gospels. By this point in our story, Jesus has fed 5,000 people, a very public act. After which he makes the incredibly provocative statement about eating his flesh and drinking his blood. And then he sneaks into the temple for the festival of the booths, where his teaching creates outrageous consternation amongst the crowds and arouses the outrage of the chief priests and the Pharisees. And since he's on a roll, Jesus continues to make more enemies by insulting the children of Abraham. And then he caps it all off by having the audacity to heal a blind man, making the point that those who say, we see, probably do not. Which brings us to this story about sheep and shepherds and sheepfolds and thieves and bandits. Now, if it was up to me, I'd have edited out most of today's gospel story and simply stuck with the line, "I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." Because frankly, on initial cursory reading, I don't really cotton to all the interpreted suggestions that are glommed on to this story, which say that in order to be square with Jesus, and consequently square with God, one must have in some form or fashion or shape confessed Jesus as one's Lord and Savior. This argument just doesn't seem to match up with what we see Jesus do with his life and with his actions. This Jesus, this good Jewish rabbi, a son of the chosen people of God, is the one who crosses into Samaria and embraces a woman for whom good Jews would have seen as anathema, an affront to God and to everything that they believe in. This Jesus is the one who ends up widening the circle of chosenness to include a Gentile pagan woman in Syrophoenicia, who the scriptures never indicate confessed Jesus as Lord and Savior. So yeah, I get a little conflicted when I compare the recorded actions of Jesus with the interpretation of today's passage that says one must be a card-carrying, confessing Christian to be included in Jesus' sheepfold, which a cursory first glance reading of today's text might lead one to believe. But luckily for us, at least in our tradition, we are called to give the scriptures more than a cursory first glance reading. In fact, we are called to, as Thomas Cranmer wrote, read, mark, and inwardly digest the words of scripture. This means that we do the homework. We put them into the historical context. We mesh them together with the whole life of Jesus. We do the hard, sometimes dirty work of making the sausage of theology in order to taste the delight of God. So given this, I invite you to consider the words of Frederick Buechner, a contemporary theologian, pastor, and darn fine preacher. Buechner wrote, "Some think of a Christian as one who necessarily believes certain things, that Jesus was the Son of God, say, or that Mary was a virgin, or that the Pope is infallible, or that all other religions are all wrong. Some think of a Christian as one who necessarily does certain things, like going to church, or getting baptized, or giving up liquor or tobacco, or reading the Bible, or doing a good deed a day. Jesus said, 'I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me.' He didn't say that any particular ethic, doctrine, or religion was the way, the truth, and the life. He said that he was. He didn't say that it was by believing or doing anything in particular that you could come to the Father. He said that it was only by him, by living, participating in, being caught up by the way of life that he embodied that was his way. Thus, it's possible to be on Christ's way and with his mark upon you without ever even having heard of Christ. And for that reason, to be on your way to God, even though maybe you don't even believe in God." Could it be, I wonder, could it be that the shepherd's arms, spread wide on the cross, are spread wide enough to embrace all of creation, to embrace every human being, whether they know it or not. In fact, isn't that the Easter message? That the light shines in the darkness, and that no matter what, whether benign neglect or ignorance or even willful avoidance, that no matter what, the darkness does not, cannot, will not overcome the light. That in the end, God wins. Love wins. I wonder if you might consider that, like Max and Rojo and Sonia and Rosie and even curmudgeonly Susie, that who, even when they are not watching for Mary, she is watching for them. I wonder if you might consider, like them, even when the children of creation are not watching for the shepherd is always watching out for them, no matter what. Perhaps on this day, in the midst of the chaos of our times, in the midst of fear and the unknownness, and just the plain old tiredness of hanging around the house waiting to be sprung from arrest, I wonder if you might consider that perhaps if you had turned your back on God or shaken your fist at God or not even really thought about God, I wonder if you might consider that God has not, will not, turn God's back on you or anyone, ever. That God is watching out for all the children of creation with widespread arms, even if they are not watching for God. Easter blessings to you, to those you love, and even to those you do not. Amen.
And now let us reaffirm our faith with the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the Holy Church of God, that it may be filled with truth and love and be found without fault at the day of your coming. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, for Scott, our own bishop, for all bishops and other ministers, and for all the holy people of God, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease and that all may be one as you and the Creator are one, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those in positions of trust, especially Donald, our president, Greg, our governor, and Betsy, our mayor, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this diocese, for those who are present and for those who are absent, that we may be delivered from hardness of heart and show forth your glory in all that we do, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have commended themselves in our prayers, for our families, friends, and neighbors, that being freed from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health. Lord, hear our prayers for those we now name.
Mary.
We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the communion of your church, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Rejoicing in the fellowships of all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord, our God.
For yours is the majesty, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier, be upon you and remain with you forever. Amen. Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia.